Here tonight, we're fortunate to have Matthew Brock, Library and Historical Collections Manager for the Mazamas. He is here to share some insight into the connection Edward Curtis had with the Mazamas. Please welcome Matthew Brock.
All right, let's see. Can you hear me? How's that? Is that good? All right. Thank you all for coming, and thank you to the Lake Oswego Reads organization for inviting the Mazamas tonight. Tonight I'm going to talk about the first 20 years of the Mazamas, roughly 1894 to 1914. My intention is to give you some insight into that early history and sort of weave in both of the Curtis brothers, as well as Theodore Roosevelt and John Muir, and a couple of other notary people in the Mazamas. Before we go on, I'd like to point out that this photo was taken by Edward Curtis on the Mount Rainier outing in 1897. It's titled Reflection Lake at the Foot of the Tatoosh Range, Mount Rainier. It's just a taste of some of the photographs to come. But our story must start with this man, William Gladstone Steele, pictured here on the right. His efforts, either directly or indirectly, influenced the story I'm going to share with you this evening. Steele was born in Ohio in 1854. He lived in Pittsburgh and Oswego, Kansas, before moving to Portland, Oregon, in 1872. While living in Kansas, sometime around 1870, he first read about Crater Lake, apparently in a newspaper that was wrapped around his lunch. That article about a lake hidden in the caldera of an extinct volcano would come to dominate his life and influence a lot of the things that he accomplished. A few years after moving to the Northwest, Steele became interested in mountaineering. Professionally, after finishing high school, he tried his hand at several different professions, including railroad development, newspaper publishing, real estate, before finally eventually becoming superintendent of the U.S. Postal Service in Portland, overseeing the mail carriers. The picture on the right, Steele is standing with his leg propped up on the curb in front of his real estate development office sometime around 1891. Steele realizes a dream in 1885 when he makes his first trip to Crater Lake. While he is there, he names Wizard Island and leaves in awe of the lake's majestic beauty. He returns to Portland determined to save the lake, and he gets straight to work helping to push for legislation to bar the development of 10 town sites around the lake. In 1886, he helps organize a U.S. Geological Survey expedition to the lake to measure its depth and map it. A year later, in 1887, he realizes another dream when he co-founds the Oregon Alpine Club, the first society of mountaineers in the Northwest. These seven gentlemen had the illustrious notoriety of illuminating Mount Hood on July 4th of that year by setting several very large fires on the mountain, something that the Park Service would definitely not allow today. Steele is not in this photo, but all of these gentlemen went on to become members of the Oregon Alpine Club. Steele uses his experience and influence in 1890 to co-sponsor the O'Neill Expedition to the Olympic Mountains in Washington State, then a vast stretch of unknown mountains outside of the Native Americans that lived there and a handful of trappers. Even though Steele was growing professionally, he and a number of other members had grown disenchanted with the direction that the Oregon Alpine Club was taking. One of the members is noted as disliking the, quote, elevator-riding mountaineers, unquote, who were subtly changing the scope of and the focus of the club. Membership had been extended to, among other things, the Oregon Camera Club, canoeists, civic boosters, and tourism promoters. In 1889, Steele assists in a reorganization of the Oregon Alpine Club to try to regain some of the alpine focus. Unfortunately, all of his efforts were for naught. By 1892, the Oregon Alpine Club had declared bankruptcy. even after Steele had infused $1,000 of his own money at the time to try to keep it afloat. Steele and a handful of others decide that they're going to take it upon themselves, and they quietly start meeting to form a new organization, draft a constitution, pick a slate of officers, and select a name. Steele's dream of a great mountaineering club, comprised of real mountaineers, was to be inaugurated atop Mount Hood, and it was decided that to climb a glaciated peak would be a requirement for membership. In March of 1894, they launched their new endeavor with newspaper ads throughout the Northwest. On the appointed day, over 350 people assembled in the small hamlet then of Government Camp, some of them having traveled for three or more days over really rough roads by horseback or buggy. And they set up a pretty sizable tent city at the base of the Mount Hood. Noted Mazama historian John D. Scott wrote in his history of the organization, quote, "Despite a formidable thunder and sleet storm which turned back 100 would-be climbers, 155 men and 38 women gained the summit on Thursday, July 19th, 1894. The piercing wind soon forced most of these to go below the sleet zone, but 40-odd hardy souls remained to formally organize the club and elect Will Steele president. Later, 105 climbers signed up as charter members. Thus, from the ashes of the now-defunct Oregon Alpine Club was born the Mazamas." Unquote. The photograph on the left is a group of climbers reaching the summit of Mount Hood via the Cooper Spur route. This party left Cloud Cap Inn. All of the people in this photograph would go on to become Mazamas. And the photo on the right is a photo collage of the newly elected members of the Mazamas, Will Steele in the center. It should be noted that two of the four vice presidents were women, and that female mountaineers have made up between one quarter and one third of the membership since the organization's inception. According to Martin Gorman, writing in 1896, the mountain goat was chosen because of its climbing ability and sure-footedness. In addition, university linguists from both the East Coast and the West Coast were consulted, and they confirmed that the word Mazama is the genus name for mountain goats, antelope, and American deer. The official badge adopted by the organization there on the right is a triangle with a dot in the center, surrounded by a circle of blue, the mountain goat on the top, and then the word Mazama. The symbol is a recognized symbol for a mountain peak. The blue signifies the sky, and the white, the alpine snow. The Mazamas of the 1890s were explorers. The January 28, 1896 Oregonian quotes Steele as talking about the ambitious scope of projects in store for the organization. Quote, "The mountains of Washington and Oregon are now unapproachable to tourists. The botany of the Cascades, there is no botany of the Cascade flora, no maps, nor even altitudes of important peaks. All of this is work for the Mazamas," Steele says. An early Mazama stood a better than even chance of persevering and summiting a mountain. That was the good news. The bad news, they had to endure days of travel over dogged roads just to reach base camp. You wouldn't know it by looking at this assembled group of people, but a lot of them climbed in what accounted to basically being old clothes or discards. But you wouldn't know it by looking at these ladies in their big hats. Sleeping on early outings, sleeping bags didn't exist. They used two big heavy woolen blankets held together with safety pins. Sustenance to carry early climbers up the mountains, oatmeal, prunes, canned beans, bacon, toast, and coffee. When it came to climbing, groups could number 100 or more following the leader up the trail, as you can see here on the left, being herded up the trail by what was commonly known as the rear guard. Rope was often just clothesline. Crampons and pitons were unheard of. Ice axes were relatively uncommon. I think at the time the organization was founded, they had four. More common were alpenstocks, more often than not made out of old farm tools and nails. Early instructions to prospective climbers were simple. Wear heavy, hobnailed boots, two pairs of wool socks. Bring an extra warm wind or waterproof coat. an alpenstock, and never forget the four G's: gloves, goggles, grease paint, and grub. By the way, the grease paint was used to ward off high-altitude sunburn and was a nasty concoction, mostly a mixture of lamp black and Vaseline. As John Scott notes, it was no trick to put on, but required a Turkish bath and sandpaper to get off. At the first official meeting of the Mazamas, not held on the top of a mountain, the officers of the club nominated and elected John Muir, along with two other scientists, as the first honorary members of the Mazamas. Muir was a fitting choice for two reasons. He was the type of person that many Mazamas strove to be, and he shared a kindred spirit for the protection and preservation of natural wonders. In an article in the 1915 annual written after Muir's death, he is described as a scholar, scientist, writer, horticulturalist, explorer, nature lover, conservationist, and poet. He was all of those things and more. The memorial concludes, quote, "To love the flowered meadows, the white silences of the uplands, the templed groves, the glacier-scarred domes, to be a lover of the out-of-doors," unquote, was not only to hold Muir in high esteem, but also to celebrate the worldview he spent his life celebrating. Muir was also honored because of his work to establish the Yosemite National Park, paralleled William Steele's years-long effort with the Crater Lake National Park. Steele and Muir met for the first time in 1888 on an early outing to Mount Rainier. And although they only met once, they remained acquaintances and kept up a correspondence over the years. They had common interests and would exchange letters. Their efforts to preserve Crater Lake and Yosemite would parallel and overlap. Both men received early local support for their campaigns and were endorsed by the state's major newspapers. They both gave public lectures to promote their cause, added by the fact that each was a known climber and an advocate for the scientific study of the mountain environment. In 1890, Steele publishes his one and only book, The Mountains of Oregon, an anthology of essays on mountaineering and his park proposal. As Stephen Mark notes in his early essay, 17 Years to Success, the book's title is interesting in light of an acknowledgement that Muir wrote to Steele shortly after receiving a copy. Quote, "I thank you for a copy of your little book, The Mountains of Oregon, and congratulate you on the success with which you have brought together in such handsome shape so much interesting and novel mountain material," unquote. Coincidentally, Muir would publish The Mountains of California in 1894. Both men would also help co-found two organizations focused on the enjoyment of the outdoors, Muir with the Sierra Club, and Steele, first with the American Alpine Club, and later with the Mazamas. Steele returned to Crater Lake in 1896, leading the Mazamas on their first big outing as an organization. Their second outing, now called the annual outing, would be to Mount Rainier in 1897. Given the difficulty and time required, to say nothing of the logistics of reaching the mountains in the late 1800s, these outings were no small feats. They often involved upwards of 100 people, traveling by boat, train, wagon, or on foot over several days just to reach base camp. In addition to climbers, there were camp cooks and porters and wagon loads of supplies to support them, for sometimes for weeks in the wilderness. This is a Edward Curtis photograph of Mount Rainier. The outing to Mount Rainier generated nationwide interest in the Pacific Northwest, its mountains, and contributed substantially to the creation of the Mount Rainier National Park in 1899. In addition to over 40 Mazamas, a contingent of climbers from the California Sierra Club, the Appalachian Mountain Club out east, and many eminent scientists were represented. In addition to Steele, the other notable members of the party included the owner of the Oregonian newspaper and one of the first people to climb Mount Rainier, Henry Pittock, one of the first vice presidents of the Mazamas, the first woman to ever climb Mount Rainier, and the first female newspaper reporter in the West, Miss Faye Fuller, Dr. E.W. Young, and a certain Mr. and Mrs. Edward Curtis of Seattle. Even though there were other experienced climbers on the outing, Pittick, Steele, and Fuller among them, Curtis was selected as the climb leader for the Mount Rainier outing due to his having spent the last several years on the mountain photographing and climbing. Prior to the climb, Curtis is said to have remarked to a friend, "It will be a grand trip, but there are too many inexperienced people in the party, and I fear before we return, some accident will bathe the trip in gloom." I'm going to take a little break here from the story and leave you with that cliffhanger. For those of you that have read Egan's book, you'll recognize a portion of this photo. Curtis is on the far left with the backpack and the satchel. If you can see, you can see his box camera hanging around his neck. Steele accumulated about 28 scrapbooks over the course of his life. We have all of them at the Mazamas, and they're a phenomenal resource not only for the organization but for Northwest history. Into them are taped and glued photographs and newspaper clippings, any kind of ephemera that caught his eye, correspondence. There's letters in there. There's all sorts of things in there, including in the scrapbook I've brought you tonight to show. There are 45 original Curtis photographs in there. On Monday, July 19th, 1897, the Mazama party left Portland by train, bound for Tacoma. From Tacoma, they again traveled by train a short distance and then by wagon, camping along the way at near Eatonville and Carnahan Ranch until reaching the end of the road at Longmire Spring. This photograph was taken on that journey in, likely somewhere near Eatonville or at the end of the road at Longmire Spring. It's a little dark. I hope you can see that. It's a farmhouse, and there's a couple of guys standing by the fence. This is one of the more stunning photographs given by Curtis to the Mazamas in 1899. It shows Mount Rainier as seen from the approach. From Longmire Spring, the party hiked into Paradise Valley, where they set up their base camp. Another view of Rainier along the way. This photograph was taken when they crossed the Marshall River on the way in. These would all be 1897. They're all part of the Rainier climb. This photograph was taken in Paradise Valley either after they had made camp or on one of the subsequent conditioning climbs. Here's a photograph of base camp. You can get an idea of the sort of the conditions of what camping was like back then. The mess tent is in the back, big canvas wall tents, another nice view of the wall tents. Whoever was in the tent on the left there had a wood stove, so they were pretty comfortable at night. As the party explored the Paradise Valley, Curtis captured these two images of the Shushkin Falls at the head of Paradise Valley. The one on the left is a close-up of the falls on the right. On Saturday, after they arrived, several members of the party made a preliminary conditioning climb up Pinnacle Peak. Curtis took this great photograph of Mount Rainier as seen between the crags atop Pinnacle Peak. This is one of the more unique and stunning photographs in our collection. A lot of Curtis photographs are landscapes or photographs of people. This one is really unique because of its starkness, its close-up, and the detail. It's the only one like it in our collection. Curtis published a small 9-page brochure entitled Scenic Washington that listed all of the photographs that he took along the trip. The numbers that you're seeing on some of these photos, including this one, come from that brochure. Within the brochure, he listed all of the photographs were numbered, and then quite a few of them he had given titles, and so I've included those where they correspond with the pictures. On Monday, the party moved up the mountain to Camp Muir, and some of the first summit attempts were made. This photograph may have been taken either on one of the conditioning climbs or on the climb up to Camp Muir. The majority of the party made their summit push on Tuesday, the 27th. This photograph was most likely taken as part of that principal climb as they reached the Stevens Glacier and made their way across it. Wonderful photo of a lone climber perched on a rocky cliff looking out over the glacier. Curtis took about 3 or 4 different photos of this same climber, and this is probably the most, I think, one of the most stunning of them. A couple others are a little bit more head-on and not quite as dramatic. After having spent the night at Camp Muir on the slopes, the party departed early the next morning for the push to the summit. Curtis captured sunrise on Gibraltar Rock. The party climbed on and reached the summit of very near around 3:30 that afternoon. This photo, taken on the slopes of the mountain, shows Edward Curtis in the foreground, leaning on his alpenstock. There's about 3 or 4 climbers further up the snowfield. 2 of them are sitting, and I think 3 or 4 of them are standing up. There are a number of high camps on the route to the summit of Mount Rainier. This one, appropriately enough, is called Camp Shivers. In the foreground, you can sort of see the backside of someone wrapped up in a blanket, and then there's 2 people sort of laying on the ground in front of him, down tucked in amongst the rocks out of the wind. It would have been a very cold way to spend the evening. You can't really see, but there's, I think, 3 or 4 alpenstocks leaning up against the rocks there. This photograph shows part of the climbing party on the summit of Mount Rainier. Edward Curtis is there on the right, sitting down with the camera on his lap and the white kerchief. Just to his right, down in the very bottom of the V, is Henry Pittock, owner of the Oregonian. Bring you back now to the story. Of the 75 climbers who started out, 59 had made the summit, a remarkable record for what we in modern times would consider amateur climbers. The death of Professor Edgar McClure of the University of Washington, who fell during the descent, cast a terrible damper on what was otherwise a successful climb and outing. In addition, 2 other climbers, Mr. H. Ainsley and Walter Rogers, were also almost killed on the same slope that claimed Professor McClure's life. Curtis recreated the rescue of Walter Rogers the next day for this photograph. This one and one very similar to it were given to the Mazamas by Walter Rogers' descendants. For his efforts, the Mazamas made Edward Curtis an honorary member in 1897. In 1889, Curtis again joined the Mazamas, this time for their 3rd annual outing to the south side of Mount St. Helens. This mountain was then in a virtually trackless wilderness. Getting to it was a formidable undertaking. The nearest farms were miles away, and the sole avenues of approach were crude trails or wagon tracks through vast stretches of dense forest. This photo of Mount St. Helens, along with the next several images from that outing, were also part of the photographs that Curtis gave to the Mazamas in 1899. The Mazamas had hired a team of mules along the way, and the mules, it had turned out, had been rounded up in Mexico and were bound for Alaska. And by all accounts, they were pretty tired of walking by the time they got to Portland. They had to be turned back shortly after Portland, and this photograph that you'll recognize not only from last night's talk, but also from Egan's book, was taken by Curtis at Indian Creek at Indian George's farm, and it was taken while they were waiting for the mule train to show up with all of their supplies. The mules never did show up. Well, they did, but they ended up showing up the next day, and from there they turned the mules back, hired a couple of local wagons, and hauled the rest of the stuff up to base camp. There's a picture of the Mount St. Helens base camp, also pretty primitive and pretty sparse. While they were there, Curtis got this beautiful photograph, and he titled it Sunset on Lake Merrill. This photograph, which Curtis had given the title Noon Rest, The Advanced Guard, shows a small party taking a break while out on a hike. Much like the Rainier outing, the St. Helens outing lasted for several weeks, and groups would often take conditioning climbs before they undertook the principal climb. Henry Pittock can be seen, 3rd from the left. He's sort of reaching up and grabbing his hat. Curtis made several important personal connections on this trip, notably Frederick Colville, chief botanist of the United States, and A.J. Johnson, who was an authority in forestry and one of the leading scientists in the United States at the time. There's a wonderful photograph of the party climbing St. Helens. You can see they're pretty well clumped together, and any of you that are climbers today would know you'd never walk that close together, and nobody's roped up, and they're probably all in wool and cotton and all sorts of. And here's the climbing party on the summit of St. Helens. This would have been in 1898. You can't really see it, but the American flag has 45 stars on it. Edward Curtis would go on to many other adventures from here, most notably the Harriman expedition to Alaska, and then on to his quest to publish The American Indian, in no small part due to some of the people that he met on his two Mazama outings. Well, it is rumored that Edward joined his brother Ashel the following year for the Mazama outing to Lake Chelan in Washington. There's no record of his involvement. And it's also around this time when he had his falling out with his brother. There is no indication that Curtis ever returned to climb with the Mazamas after this. These are scans of an article that appeared in Harper's Weekly in New York after the Mazamas climbed Mount Rainier, and all of these photographs were taken by Edward Curtis. And Ashel Curtis followed his brother's footsteps and joined the Mazamas in 1899. To take part in that year's outing to Lake Chelan. More remote than the trip to Mount St. Helens the year before, kept the number of participants low, the party set out to climb a group of unnamed peaks in the northwest of the Park Creek Pass. Roughly 30 climbers began the ascent, but that number dropped after a near accident almost claimed the climb leader, Dr. Young, who you'll remember was in the previous outings. He served as Curtis's assistant climb leader for both the Rainier and the St. Helens outing. Young slipped on the icy snow on the ascent and was saved from plummeting over a 300-foot cliff when he slammed into a ridge of stunted trees. The accident so shook up the party that only 17 people finished the climb. This photo was taken after their ascent of Mount Shushkin. Ashel is seated on the right, and fellow climber Montelius Price is standing behind him. If you can look closely, Ashel is taking an early selfie. Ashel returned in 1901 and joined the Mazamas on a return to Mount Hood. This, their eighth annual outing, was notable for several reasons. The Mazamas were joined by Professor Henry Fielding Reed of Johns Hopkins University. Professor Reed was along to study the many glaciers on Mount Rainier, and he gave many talks at camp in the evening, which was a pretty common practice at the time. They would, anybody notable or science, if there was a scientist along, they would often give campfire talks in the evening after the climbing was over and after dinner on geology, botany, glaciology in Reed's case. The Mazamas went in honor of Reed's scientific work. They named Reed Glacier on Mount Hood in his honor. Given the close proximity to Portland, the Mazamas got 97 climbers safely up and down the mountain without incident. Ashel took part in the 1902 annual outing, this time to Mount Adams. The party left Portland by steamer bound for White Salmon. From White Salmon, they traveled by stagecoach to Trout River and then by foot on to Snowline at Mount Adams. After making camp in Happy Valley, they spent several days waiting for the weather to clear by exploring the nearby areas before making an early start for the summit on the 21st of July. After 7.5 hours of, quote, unrelenting and unpitying steepness, as you can tell by this photograph, that has not been adjusted. You see the guy here on the left, he's standing straight up, so that's about a 45-degree slope they're climbing. The group reached the summit among a bitter wind and a chilling mist that turned back several climbers immediately. Those that remained were treated to a transformative scene that would remain impressive to them for the rest of their climbing career. One of them wrote, quote, the fog parted asunder, the cloud cap burst into shreds, and the stupendous mountain outlines and wild blue plains began to be visible through the rents, unquote. Within minutes, they could see Hood, Jefferson, and the Three Sisters, all as clear as if they were but a dozen miles away. This photograph was taken by Ashel Curtis on the climb. It's not in the Mazamas collection, but it's such a beautiful picture that I included it here. We have quite a few pictures that Ashel took on it on the climb, but I chose this one because it's so dramatic. This one's held by the Washington State Historical Society. The annual outing of 1905 was one of the largest yet for the Mazamas. In addition to the 51 Mazamas, they were joined by 58 climbers from the California Sierra Club. Ashel, by this time having moved to California, had switched to the Sierra Club, and he was listed as one of the four climb leaders for their party. The Sierra Club broke a record on the day of the climb by putting the largest party ever assembled on the summit in one day. By all accounts, the two groups had a grand time together, exchanging good-natured taunts and raiding parties between their respective camps, while sharing guiding responsibilities and gear over their 2 days of summit climbs. The Mazamas have none of Ashel's photographs from this outing. This photograph of these five dapper Mazama sitting on a log is from the Kaiser collection. Ashel joined the Mazamas for the last time in 1906 as part of the annual outing to Mount Baker. The Mazamas set for themselves their most challenging endeavor yet, to make the first ascent of Mount Baker from the northeastern side. The outing lasted for 2 months and saw 120 members trekking 20 miles through uncharted wilderness northwest of the mountain. They established a base camp named in honor of the Mazama president at the time, Charles Scholes, on the shore of Lower Galena Lake. From camp, the party undertook scientific investigations of the sulfur caves, steam vents, and an inventory of the northwest botany of the northwest slope. They encountered a wide variety of wildlife, including something that they referred to as a wood rat that stole sweaters out of camp, and a brown bear tromped through the middle of camp on its way to the huckleberry fields. They launched several exploratory trips to scout routes up the mountain and were awakened at 3 a.m. one morning when a forest fire broke out 200 yards from camp. They cajoled a mule train carrying food, blankets, and supplies over 3 miles up the slope of the mountain, across steep snowfields and glacier crevasses to establish their upper camp. In the end, they made 3 ascents over 4 days, one that involved a perilous straight-line climb up the Mazama Glacier by a hand-picked group of 6 people that included Ashel. They named many geological features on the mountain, including the Mazama Dome, and several glaciers, the grandest of which, with its miles of castellated ice and thunderous avalanches, is said to have reminded Charles Scholes of then-President Theodore Roosevelt. This photograph, captured by Ashel Curtis, shows the party on the slopes as they headed up to their upper camp. That same year, 1906, the Mazamas nominated Theodore Roosevelt for the second time to honorary membership. They'd first nominated him back in 1905, because of his lifelong interest in the mountains, scenery, forests, and particularly for his interest and help in securing Crater Lake National Park. When Roosevelt signed the legislation creating the park in 1902, it capped a 17-year effort by William Steele, and the creation of the park was something that Steele considered his greatest achievement. Roosevelt had been a key figure in the adoption of the park, having influenced the House of Representatives to take up debate on the legislation. Unbeknownst to Roosevelt, his secretary had declined the Mazama's offer of honorary membership. A few months later, in 1906, in February of 1906, Roosevelt accepted honorary membership in the American Alpine Club. This greatly upset William Steele. He fired off a letter to the president asking, "Why did you accept the American Alpine Club's offer but reject ours?" A series of letters fly back and forth between Washington and Portland. Once it became clear to Roosevelt that the initial nomination had been made and subsequently rejected, the president apologized for the misunderstanding and accepted the Mazama's offer of honorary membership. They renominated him in August of 1906. This action prompted a still upset and offended Steele to resign from the Mazamas. Several years passed as the Mazamas debated the issue and President Scholes tried to soothe Steele's bruised pride. The Mazamas eventually make Roosevelt an honorary member in 1913. As a thank you, he sends this lovely photo from his great African outing. Across the bottom, it says, "Good luck to the Mazamas, Theodore Roosevelt." Steele would not rejoin the Mazamas until 1921, but he would remain a member until his death in 1934. In their first 20 years, from 1894 to 1914, the Mazamas mounted successful climbs of mountains Hood, Adams, Jefferson, St. Helens, Rainier, Baker, Shasta, Glacier Peak, and the Three Sisters, many of them multiple times. They organized and printed the Mazama Annual, and later in 1928, that was joined by a monthly bulletin, both publications that continue to this day. Some of you are holding the latest edition of that in your hands. They sent scientific expeditions to measure the elevations of Mount Rainier and Mount St. Helens, as well to document the geology, ecology, glaciology, and meteorology of the majority of mountain peaks in the Northwest. The organization was honored with the naming of Mount Mazama, the extinct volcano whose crater cradles Crater Lake. They named Mount Sahali from the organization's Chinook Indian motto, and in their first conservation project, lobbied successfully to save the Cascade Forest Reserve from public sale. Large parts of that we now know as the Willamette National Forest. What began as William Gladstone Steele dream of a new mountain club with 105 members on the summit of Mount Hood has grown over the past 121 years into an organization 3,600 members strong. Currently, the organization leads over 1,000 outings a year, climbs, hikes included, provides educational opportunities across a wide variety of areas, is active in scientific investigation and conservation activities. The Mazama Library and Historical Collections are honored to have the Curtis Brothers' photographs as part of their collection. Together, their images give life to the early days of not only the Mazamas, but mountaineering in the Northwest. I hope you've enjoyed this short history as much as I've enjoyed sharing it with you. Wonderful. All right. Thank you, everybody. Thanks for coming.